Hachette Audio presents The Chaos Machine, the inside story of how social media rewired our minds and our world. Written by Max Fisher, read by Peter Ganim. To Mom and Dad, for getting me here. To Jordan, for seeing me through. Author's note. This book is based on interviews with hundreds of people who have studied, combated, exploited, or been affected by social media, as well as with workers and executives in Silicon Valley. All interviews were conducted on the record, save one, with a third-party moderator who asked to remain pseudonymous. I reviewed pay stubs and corporate files that confirm his account. The book also draws heavily on academic research, court records, and many other primary sources. A handful of statements draw on scholarly research that has not yet been published outside this book. All source information, along with overviews of the methodology and findings of important research, can be found in the notes section at the end of the print edition of this book. Prologue. Consequences. Walking into Facebook's headquarters can feel like entering the Vatican, a center of power shrouded in secrecy and opulence that would shame a Russian oligarch. The company had spent $300 million alone on building Number 21, an airy steel and glass playground of gardens, patios, and everything-is-free restaurants that I visited in late 2018. Between meetings, a two-story mural on a back wall caught my eye, reminding me of a famous Chinese artist who'd recently been featured at the Guggenheim Museum. I asked the PR rep who was minding me if it had been deliberately painted in his style. She laughed politely. It was no mimicry. The artist had been flown in to do an original on Facebook's walls. So had dozens of other artists. All around me, fabulously paid programmers hustled down hallways adorned by priceless murals. In my bag, stuffed between notepads, was my ticket in. 1,400-plus pages of internal documents from regions across the globe that revealed Facebook's unseen hand in setting the bounds of acceptable politics and speech for 2 billion users worldwide. To the insider who'd leaked them to me, the files were evidence of the company's sloppiness and shortcuts in trying to stem the growing global turmoil that he believed its products exacerbated or even caused. To me, they were even more than that. They were a window into how Facebook's leadership thought about the consequences of social media's rise. Like many, I had initially assumed social media's dangers came mostly from misuse by bad actors, propagandists, foreign agents, fake news peddlers, and that at worst, the various platforms were a passive conduit for society's pre-existing problems. But virtually everywhere I traveled in my reporting, covering far-off despots, wars, and upheavals, strange and extreme events kept getting linked back to social media. A sudden riot, a radical new group, widespread belief in some oddball conspiracy, all had a common link. And though America had yet to explode into violence, the similarities to what was happening back home were undeniable. Every week, there was another story of a Twitter conspiracy overtaking national politics, a Reddit subculture drifting into neo-Nazism, a YouTube addict turning to mass murder. And Donald Trump's unexpected victory in 2016 had been attributed, in part, to social media. Though the role of the platforms remained poorly understood, it was already clear that Trump's rise had been abetted by strange new grassroots movements and hyper-partisan outlets that thrived online, as well as Russian agents who'd exploited social media's reality-distorting, identity-indulging tendencies. This global pattern seemed to indicate something fundamental to the technology, but exactly what that was, why it was happening, or what it meant, nobody was able to tell me. At the other end of the world, a young man I'll call Jacob, a contractor with one of the vast outsourcing firms to which Silicon Valley sends its dirty work, had formed much the same suspicions as my own. He had raised every alarm he could. His bosses had listened with concern, he said, even sympathy. They'd seen the same things he had. Something in the product they oversaw was going dangerously wrong. Jacob, slight and bookish, had grown up in love with the internet and had been tinkering with computers for years. The technologies seemed to represent the best of the United States. He'd looked up especially to web moguls like Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook's CEO and founder, who argued that connecting the world would make it better. When Jacob landed a job with an outsourcing agency that reviewed user content for Facebook and Instagram, one of several that the company employs worldwide, it felt like becoming part of history. Every day, his team clicked through thousands of posts from around the world, flagging any that broke a rule or crossed a line. It was draining but necessary work, he felt. But over some months in 2017 and 2018, they had noticed the posts growing more hateful, more conspiratorial, and more extreme. And the more incendiary the post, they sensed, the more widely the platforms spread it. It seemed to them like a pattern, one playing out at once in the dozens of societies and languages they were tasked with overseeing. Moreover, they believed that their ability to constrain this rising hate and incitement was hamstrung by the very thing that was supposed to help them, the dozens of secret rule books dictating what they were to allow on the platforms and what to remove. To Facebook's more than 2 billion users, those rules are largely invisible. They are intended to keep the platforms safe and civil, articulating everything from the line between free expression and hate speech to the boundaries of permissible political movements. But as the rulebooks proved inadequate to stemming harms that were often ginned up by the platform itself, and as corporate oversight of this most unglamorous part of the business drifted, the worldwide guides had sprawled to hundreds of confusing and often contradictory pages. Some of the most important, on identifying terrorist recruitment or overseeing contentious elections, were filled with typos, factual errors, and obvious loopholes. The sloppiness and the lacunae suggested a dangerous disregard for a job that Jacob saw as a matter of life and death, and at a time when the platforms were overflowing with extremism that increasingly bled into the real world. Just months earlier, in Myanmar, the United Nations had formally accused Facebook of allowing its technology to help provoke one of the worst genocides since World War II. Jacob recorded his team's findings and concerns to send up the chain. Months passed. The rise in online extremism only worsened. He clocked in and out, waiting at his terminal for a response from headquarters, far away in America, that never came. He had an idea. It would mean cracking the security system at work, secreting confidential files abroad, and convincing the media to broadcast his warnings for him, all in the hope of delivering them to the screen of one person, Mark Zuckerberg, founder and CEO of Facebook. Distance and bureaucracy, he was sure, kept him from reaching the people in charge. If only he could get word to them, they would want to fix things. Jacob first reached me in early 2018. A series of stories I'd worked on, investigating social media's role in spinning up mass violence in places like the small Asian nation of Sri Lanka, struck him as confirmation that the problems he'd observed on his screen were real and had growing, sometimes deadly, consequences. But he knew that his word alone would not be enough. He would need to siphon Facebook's internal rulebooks and training documents from the computers at his office. It wouldn't be easy. The machines were heavily locked down and the office closely monitored, but it was possible. A year earlier, someone had managed to pass some of the files to The Guardian, and more were later leaked to Vice News. Jacob built a program to secrete the files out, encrypting and washing them to remove digital fingerprints that might trace back to him or even the country where his office was located. He transferred some to me through a secure server. A few weeks later, I flew out to gather the rest and to meet him. Facebook, on learning what I'd acquired, invited me to their sleek headquarters, offering to make a dozen or so corporate policymakers available to talk. All were tough-minded professionals. Some had accrued sterling reputations in Washington, D.C., in fields such as counterterrorism or cybersecurity, before joining the Silicon Valley gold rush. Others had impressive backgrounds in human rights or politics. They were hardly the basement hackers and starry-eyed dropouts who had once...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.